morning.
Welcome to worship today. Nice to have you here. Looks like winter's come. It was really coming down on my drive over this morning. So put your long underwear off and hunker down. I guess we've learned to hunker down these last months. Today is Christ the King Sunday. That means it's the last Sunday of the church year. The church year begins next Sunday, the first Sunday of Advent. Advent is four Sundays of preparation for the birth of the Christ child. That starts on Christmas. And the season of Christmas lasts 12 days. 12 days of Christmas. I think that's where they got that song. We're a liturgical church. The word liturgical, the root word is liturgy, which we have, and it literally means people at work. So in a liturgical church, you have someone, a leader like me, say, Lord be with you, and your response is,
and also with you.
Also with you. After each petition of prayer, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. If you go to a non-liturgical church like our Baptist brothers and sisters or evangelical free, they'll have someone come up and lead a prayer. They'll have someone read a lesson, but there's no give and take, and when we do our musical liturgy, it's always a give and take, people at work, and we're doing our worship together. We also follow a church year, so we've got Advent, 4 weeks, Christmas, 12 days, then we enter into Epiphany, a season of Epiphany, talk about Christ is the King, and it's 4 to 7 weeks, depending on when Easter is, then we enter into 40 days of Lent. Color is purple, and that leads up to Holy Week and Easter is the perfect number, 7 weeks. Its color is white, symbolizing purity. Then we have this long season called Pentecost, in which this is the last Sunday of Pentecost. So that's one of the differences between liturgical churches and non-liturgical churches. Doesn't mean one is better than another. We're all in this together. We're all brothers and sisters in Christ. And that's what I'm going to kind of focus our thoughts on, that how blessed it is to be a member of a church. We have brothers and sisters all over the world, in every country, every nationality, every language. And I don't think we remember that. Today we're going to remember that a little bit. See, some people brought there. Ooh, I forgot mine again. Rice Aroni, this month we're doing. We might as well do it next month, too. And any macaroni or rice products, okay, for a food shelf. Are these soups, Linda?
No, it's got a lemon dish macaroni.
Cheeseburger, elbow pasta, and a creamy cheddar cheese sauce. I've never seen those before. Anyway, it's nice to have you worshiping. Let's open the prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us safely to a new day. Help us to embrace the day as it comes. As we worship here, allow us to enter into fellowship with you through your Holy Spirit. We pray that our hearts and minds and ears and eyes might be open. That we might hear again of your love for us and challenge us to love one another. Send your Spirit, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Opening hymn. What do we have today?
Yes.
Crown you with many crowns.
Oh,
the order of confession and forgiveness. We open the worship in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved. Amen. Let's take a moment for silent confession. Let us confess together. Holy One,
we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen.
Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let's join together in praying the prayer of the day. Let us pray. O God of
power and might, your Son shows us the way of service, and in him we inherit the riches of your grace. Give us the wisdom to know what is right, and the strength to serve the world you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
A reading from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. In this passage, God is praised for revealing ultimate divine power in raising Jesus from the dead. The resurrected, exalted Christ is Lord of both the church and the entire universe, now and in the age to come. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints? And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power? God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read the psalm responsively by whole verse. Psalm 95, verses 1-7a. We are the people of God's pasture and the sheep of God's hand. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to the Lord with psalms.
For you, Lord, are a great God and a great ruler above all gods.
In your hand are the caverns of the earth. The heights of the hills are also yours.
The sea is yours, for you made it, and your hands have molded
us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For the Lord is our God. We are the people of God's pasture and the sheep of God's hand.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Gospel lesson for this Christ the King Sunday is found in the 25th chapter of St. Matthew, beginning with the 31st verse. Jesus said to the disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food, and I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me something to wear. I was sick and you took care of me. Was in prison and you visited me.' And the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, and thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly, I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, who are members of my family, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into eternal fire prepared for you for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?' Then he will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." The word of God, the word of life. Please be seated as we move into our sermon.
Son of God and Son of Man.
Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I was reading an article yesterday about the year 2020, and it occurred to me that 2020 is probably the best year we've ever had. And I know everyone's saying it's the worst year. We got to get over 2020. It's got to get better. Listen to this. This is what I was reading. In 1920, I don't think you guys did it, but women, when they washed their laundry, it took 11 and a half hours to do your laundry for a week. This year, it takes, at least this article said, an hour and 15 minutes. Jesus, in his days, that was 2,000 years ago, they lived until they were age 30. In 1900, they lived until they were 31, the average age of death. On the earth today, in 2020, we live to 71 and a half. That's around the globe. I mean, so we live better and longer. In this article, they said that because of nanotechnology and cell and gene manipulation, in another 20 years, we might live to 100 to 150. I don't know if I want to live that long, but maybe our grandkids, huh? Childhood deaths in 1990. In 1990, that's only 30 years ago, there were 12 million childhood deaths. In 2017, there were only 5 million. I mean, so we're living longer, better, faster than we've ever lived. 2020 can't be all that bad. John D. Rockefeller, one of the richest men in the world 100 years ago, he didn't have any air conditioning. He didn't have the medicine we have. He wasn't able to travel like we do and see things that we do. I mean, he didn't have the drive-in restaurant. He never had the worries, you know. As wealthy and as much as he had, he didn't have what you and I have available to us today. He didn't have social media. Well, maybe that was a good thing. Maybe that's the best thing he had. He didn't have that monkey business going on. But the thought occurred to me that now is the best time the world has ever had. And it seems like if we change our thinking a little bit about this, we'll get a new perspective and we'll start to appreciate all the things, the life we have been given in 2020. This week we celebrate Thanksgiving. Charles Dickens wrote in the 1820s, 1830s, we were celebrating Thanksgiving then. He said, you Americans got it all wrong. You only take one day a year to say thank you? You should say thank you every day of your life and take one day and complain. No. Made a lot of sense to me. Huh? Every day, if we put on the mindset of thanking God, I think our life would be much, much different because we've got many, many, many blessings. We're alive. We have hope of a future to stop this pandemic. We've got people who love us and people who we can love. I remember in one of my congregations, John was a lawyer, twice divorced, a little overweight, out of shape, feeling kind of sorry for himself, had some money problems, couldn't get going. And when we were talking, I asked him how he had changed over the time I'd seen him. I said, how did you get out of that? He says, I decided that every day I was going to write a thank you note to someone. So I wrote thank yous to my parents and my kids and to my teachers and to my employees. Every day I wrote a thank you note. He says, after about a year, my whole life changed. I was living a life of thanksgiving. And I wasn't down and out like I was. I wasn't feeling sorry for myself. He said, my perspective on life changed overnight, you know. His relationship improved. He left his negative mindset. And he noticed that he had a lot to be thankful for. And I think I'm going to try and put that to work in my life. Because perspective is very, very important, how we see and how we live it out. Paul, in the Ephesians lesson that you read in Helen, says, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in all the things that I've done. And he remembers the people in Ephesus and how they were loving each other and praying for each other, supporting one another and bringing love to bear wherever they traveled. They were just such a good witness. I never stopped giving thanks for you, Paul said. I think that would be a good watchword for us, especially as we enter into Thanksgiving. We've got so much to be thankful for. Paul was saying his church was amazing. This church is amazing. Think of all the good things you have done. I was teaching the sixth graders this week, confirmation, and I looked back to the history of this church and pointed to the banner that was formed this church in 1883. I said, think of all the good things people have had happen to them from 1883 to now. And I said, how old is the church? And the kids, sixth graders, get out and do their math. But think of all the love that's gone through this place. All the funerals where we surrounded people who were mourning the loss of loved ones. All the weddings that have been done. All the baptisms that have been done. All the visits that I've made. All the food that we have shared. I give thanks for you. That's what Paul is saying. We are the body of Christ. And as much as you have done it unto the least of these, Jesus says, you've done it unto me. So we've got so much to be thankful for. The church is amazing. It's an instant family. Huh? As I said at the beginning, we've got brothers and sisters in every nation, in every language around the world. We're family. And we do a lot of good. Today we're building a hospital in Tanzania. Tomorrow we're building a school in the Philippines. We're helping the firemen out in Oregon and in California through our disaster relief and the tornadoes and hurricanes that are down south. You and I are, because the offering that we make, portions of that go to support that work. We're intertwined with our brothers and sisters around the world. One of the first people that came down with COVID-19 in Missouri was a guy named Chris Baumgartner, and he was hesitant to tell anybody in his neighborhood that he had COVID-19, because he was thinking everyone would treat him like lepers, like, we don't want you to come around here, we don't want anything to do with you, we don't want to get sick. He said the word got out, and he got more cards and more love, and every one of those cards, he says, I'll be praying for you. I'll be supporting you. I'm there for you. Can I help in any way? He said, that's what the body of Christ does. That's what we as a church do. We're praying for you. Paul was thankful for the church, so he prayed for the church. That made me think, how often do I pray for the church? I should pray more often. I think those who pray for the church will be more involved in participating in helping the church do its ministry and caring for one another. In fact, I started thinking as I was working on this that the people in my years as a pastor who have complained are probably the ones who don't pray for the church. And they've got things to complain about. How often do we pray for the church? How often do we pray for this world of Christian believers? Last thing I think was we should be thankful, especially for the gift of salvation at confirmation the other night. I'm trying to define terms that we just throw out without even talking about them. Salvation, the word salvation came up. Salvation, or I'm saved, the root word of salvation is salve. Salve is a healing ointment. A salve that comes from God to me and to you heals from our hurts and from our beatings and from our wounds and from our pain. And God loves us for some reason, as unlovable and unlikable and that once. I was preaching on the Jesus breaking bread, two loaves, and I said, is it two loaves and five fish, or five loaves and two fishes? And the little gal who had Down syndrome hollered out, it's five loaves and two fishes, I read the book. Anyway, Paul was struck blind for 3 days, and when he came out of it, he heard the voice of God saying, love my people, and he changed from a zealot to writing half of the books in the New Testament, and he was so thankful. Even when he was persecuted himself, he was beaten and scourged and shipwrecked 3 times, sharing the love of God, but he was blessed. Whether I live or whether I die in the Lord, he was blessed. And that's you and me. We need to overflow with thanksgiving. And I hope that you and I can be overflowing with thanksgiving this week. We can complain about the virus and complain about this and complain about that. But if you want to get through it, fill yourself with thanksgiving. Overflow with thanksgiving. Amen. May God's peace and love be with us all these days. Amen. Let us please rise and join in the prayers of intercession. Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all who are in need. Let's take a moment for silent prayer. Sovereign of all, train our ears to hear your cry and the needs of those around us. Bless all social ministries of the church in which we seek to serve others as we ourselves have been served. Hear us, O God. You cause rain to fall on the just and the unjust alike. Direct our use of creation to provide for the needs of all people in ways that are sustainable for the earth. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Bring peace to every place where the conflict rages. Grant opportunities for ending divisions among us and usher in your reign of unity and reconciliation. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Heal the sinful divisions we erect between us and release us from the systems of oppression and prejudice. Restore our capacity to see your image and those whose dignity we have stripped away. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Pour out the gifts of your Spirit on children and youth throughout the church. Sustain those who work in children's ministry, youth ministry, campus ministry, as they nurture the gifts of young people. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray, O Lord, that you might be with this congregation as they seek a pastor. We pray that you might be with members of this congregation as we celebrate Thanksgiving this week. We pray that you might be with this congregation as we seek to live our lives for you, especially those who are sick, those who are fighting the problems that are caused by the epidemic. Watch over our loved ones too, Lord, wherever they find themselves. Thank you for saints now departed who fed the hungry, clothed the naked, and tended to the sick. Inspire us by their example, that we may see your presence in those in need around us. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. So we gather at the Lord's table and invite everyone to take their bread. Our Lord Jesus at his last supper. took bread and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of Christ is given for you. And after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of your sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The blood of Christ is shed for you. The body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthen and preserve you into everlasting life. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Let's join in the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us join in the prayer after communion. Lord Jesus, in this
simple meal you have set a banquet, sustain us on the journey, strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children, and give us glad and generous hearts as we meet you on your way. Amen.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our closing hymn is "Soon and Very Soon."
We are going to see the King. Hallelujah.